Welcome to a new edition of the Famous Interviews with Joe Dimino. On this episode, we talk with author, hypnotherapist, and survivor Michelle Walters. After a 20-plus year career in digital marketing, she shifted gears and became a hypnotherapist. She considers herself a marketing persuader that has become a guide to helping people persuade themselves of something new. She has had quite a bit of personal struggles in her own life, losing both her son's father, her husband to a stroke, as well as a wonderful life partner who passed in late 2021. Michelle has suffered a lot of grief, yet she always remains optimistic, positive, and very compassionate. She has a wonderful story. Enjoy this interview.
Before we get into your life, it looks like you've had quite a dramatic career shift in your life. Yeah. I want to know, how did you survive COVID? It was quite a time the last couple of years. How did you survive that time period, and how has it subsequently changed you, you know, the way that you live your life and the way that you conduct business now that we're kind of getting back to things and things are opening up?
Oh, my life is, 170 degrees different from where I was pre-COVID. I have relocated twice, sold my house, my partner died, and I changed businesses. So, you know, I'm in a completely different, I'm the same person, I guess, mostly, but I'm in an extremely different situation from where I was before COVID started. One that is in some ways better, in other ways worse, but dramatically different and off to a different racetrack.
Well, peppered in there in all of that is just, there's so much, you know, and I think that's kind of the way that this pandemic was. There was things that were silver linings, there's things that were really bad. So I guess realistically, what is it now that's better about your life, and what is it now that's worse about your life now that, you know, kind of everything's waking up and we're getting into a new existence, so to speak?
Well, I mean, what's worse is missing my life partner. That's dramatically worse. And he'd been sick before COVID, then during COVID he had a stroke and started having seizures, and his kidneys failed, and that aspect of my life has really ended, and my relationship with him ended because he died tragically. The part of my life that is a little bit brighter, or perhaps is sort of a star coming into its own existence, is I really feel that my book and the work I'm doing now is taking me in a different direction, and one where I'll be able to help others in new ways and more people, and that's inspiring to me.
Okay, so before we get into your life, your career change, I want to take you in front of a bunch of third graders at a career day, and one of them looks up at you and says, "What do you do for a living?" How would you answer them?
I've thought about the answer to this question, and because I've seen a similar question posted on the internet, you know, describe what you do in a funny way kind of thing. I talk to other people so that they improve the way they talk to themselves.
I like it.
I talk to other people so that they improve the way they talk to themselves.
So it's hypnotherapy, correct? And that's along with writing, it's hypnotherapy?
I do hypnotherapy, and I do executive coaching, and I wrote a book last year, earlier this year.
Okay, so before we get into that, you had quite a career change. You had a 20-plus year career in digital marketing.
Yep.
And you got out of that. What was it about that life that you just couldn't do anymore, and why did you choose this career path that you're on now?
What I was doing before was working for me, and it was innovative, and I liked that it was sort of constantly changing and shifting, but it was too much sort of, I don't want to say at the mercy, but too much sort of following what other people set for my agenda, and now I can do what I want to do under my own agenda. And I really believe that my superpower, my raison d'etre is to help people in their personal transformation. And that's not something that I could do when I was developing email campaigns for Clorox and Schwab.
So I guess, you know, being in that capacity to help others, you know, it's a pretty big responsibility. How long did you know that that's something that you possessed? How long did you suppress it before you actually let it come out?
I think it's something that I have always been doing, but it's not something that I have been doing at the same scale or in a professional manner. I've functioned this way for family and friends for decades, honestly. But I retrained in hypnotherapy and have found that that is just such an outstanding tool to help people make rapid progress on recognizing what's going on with their subconscious and changing their thinking. And it's so rewarding to help people that way. I'm, you know, lifting off, as they say, with my new business. It's certainly not flying high yet, but it feels so good and so right because this is naturally who I am.
You know, what's interesting about what you said about the subconscious and how all of that works is that there's a lot of times where I'll wake up after I have a dream, which is your subconscious kind of playing around. Mm-hmm. And it's such a good feeling. It's like, it's me, but it's not me cognizant in a conscious way of it. And it's such a good thing. So that has to be a really interesting human realm to delve into for somebody, because you're really getting into things that people feel but somehow suppress or they're not cognizant of it. Is that kind of a fascinating part of what you do with the human psyche when you deal with that?
Oh, what the work I do is absolutely fascinating. It's absolutely fascinating to work with people and to be so trusted that together I can lead them. Because that's really what I'm doing. I'm leading people to help discover what is inside of them that can help to heal them, that can help to find that breakthrough. And whether it's finding the reason for a phobia or changing a pattern so that somebody doesn't continue an unproductive behavior, or recognizing what things from the past they can bring into the present in order to improve their self-confidence, whatever they're missing, whatever they need right now. My work is just fantastic, and I love doing it.
In any line of work that obviously someone like me or just a regular person out there that's not really hip to hypnotherapy or they don't understand it, if you could boil down one of the biggest perceptions and misperceptions of the way the mind works, the way the subconscious works in a typical person, what would it be? What would be the top revelation that you would say that you've gained from really delving into this work?
Well, I think the first thing to do is to clarify the difference between hypnosis and hypnotherapy. So hypnosis is the broader term. And many people have misconceptions that when they've seen hypnosis in the movies or when they've seen someone at a comedy club doing hypnosis, that that's what would it be like for themselves to be using hypnosis to work on something. And it's just not like that at all. I don't have a swinging pocket watch. I don't make people cluck like chickens. But what I do is help people get very, very relaxed so that they can access parts of their mind that have been kind of buried or clouded, or that they don't remember those memories. And by helping somebody to bring forth what's going on in those deeper places in their mind, all kinds of creative solutions come up and abilities to change the way you think and act come forth. And so with that technique of using the practice of hypnosis, which hypnosis is something that we all go into states of hypnosis in and out of every day, and certainly before you fall asleep and when you wake up in the morning. But this is a special way of using that brain state, that state of mind, in order to encourage healing and change. And that's that's the work I love to do with people.
Let's go back to when you were a child. What did you dream about being when you grew up? What did you want to do?
When I was a kid, I think I thought the only thing to do was to be a teacher, because most of the people in my life were teachers. And in a way, I have become a teacher. I'm just not teaching in a classroom of teenagers or young people. Now I'm teaching primarily adults, usually 25 to 60, to change the way they're thinking. It is teaching, but it's not the kind of teaching I imagined doing when I was a kid.
And this is obviously in the profession of helping people and in a more highly specialized way of mentally helping people. How did these seeds begin in you growing up? What did you see? Who were role models? What were motivators for you to become who you are now?
I was always fascinated by the power of the mind, and I was always fascinated by things that happened that you couldn't explain. You know, I remember one day I came home from camp and a friend of mine had stayed home and she had a little stuffed toy and it was a fox. And then she got another fox while I was on vacation. And the first fox was named Ruff and she named the second fox Reddy. And I came home from vacation or from this camp I had been to and my unit at the camp was called Ruff and Reddy. And here my friend had named her second little toy Ready so that they could be Rough and Ready. And this was the name of my camp name. And I was always wondering, like, what, why is that? Why are there synchronicities that are kind of inexplicable that happen in our lives all the time? And really trying to understand kind of what goes on either within an individual's mind or within some sort of larger, super conscious, out there kind of one mind. And so I think, you know, these questions, this seeking, this curiosity did exist from my childhood. And now it's something that I use to work with people in terms of helping them to grow more curious and more, become better listeners to what they hear from their own subconscious or superconscious.
You know, sometimes artwork is a really big part of how we develop. And I'm curious, was there an album or a book for you or artwork that really inspired you?
Oh, gosh, there's so many. I don't know where to start. I've always been a huge lover of music, played music as a child, into music as an adult, big lover of art. The Italian Renaissance paintings are coming to mind. I have a couple books on my shelf about how to use art to better access your subconscious. So I can't name one thing in particular, but I do believe that the arts, the broader sense of arts, are all part of how we express our spirit. And that's why we're here. You know, I watched a bunch of kids over the holidays joking about sort of what's the purpose of life? Well, best as I can tell, it's to express your spirit. And that's what I try and help people to do.
So if you can meet anybody alive on the planet right now and talk to them, who would it be? Who would you love to meet?
I don't know. I'm going to say Michelle Obama. I recently listened to a clip from her book, and she strikes me as a really interesting person, a great leader, and it would be fun to have a cup of coffee with her.
That's one of the top answers all the time, for sure. It is. If I take a poll, she's right up there, probably number one overall.
I bet. Well, she's intriguing,
yeah.
Right? You know.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd like to talk to both of them. I think it would be cool to kind of just get an idea of, I don't know, just anything. And it wouldn't even be anything specific, because that's just who they are.
Yeah,
it would be fun.
They're just interesting people. They've made movies. They've done really interesting things.
Yeah, they have for sure. So let's say you have a dream tonight. You run into your 20-year-old version of yourself, and you could give that version a piece of advice based on the wisdom that you've gained throughout your life, what you've learned. What would you tell your young version?
To be less afraid. to be less afraid and to be less sensitive to the judgments of others. I think that would be good advice for me, and I think it's good advice for a lot of people. We spend a lot of our time being so worried about what other people are going to think or do. And I don't mean encouraging people to act in ways that are irresponsible or non-respectable. But I think if I had been more brave 20 years ago, I can't imagine where I could be right now.
I remember years ago, I got a book at a thrift store on ESP, and I just started reading it about just the whole world of it, and, you know, like lucid dreaming and all of that. What I came to the conclusion of is that your brain is a mighty powerful place. We were talking about a place where we only really tap into, you know, 10 to 20% of what it's capable of. Is there a truism based on what you do that people can tap in and harness into the power of their brains and figure more out and have a healthier existence than we do?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm going to say that a huge part of my life, I've been trying to understand the difference between brain and mind. And I don't have a perfect explanation, but I think of the brain as being a physical construct that is key to the idea of mind. Mind being reliant on the physical structure of the brain, but also being related to other structures. Like, we have neurons in our heart. We have knowledge of how our bodies work in every cell of our body. So it's really an even bigger idea than that. I believe that there's, you know, some people call it the Akashic Records or the One Mind or Universal Intelligence, but I do believe that there is this other source of tremendous knowledge and ways for us to communicate with each other that are not limited to what we physically see and understand right now. And that by developing one's openness to recognizing that there are a lot of things going on that we can't explain, and that some of them might have explanations we haven't been able to scientifically prove yet. But by developing one's own intuition and sensory perception through whatever senses those are, people can really become bigger than they are right now and happier as they express their spirit.
So who's your role model? Who's your hero?
Oh, well, a major one of my heroes passed away last year. I had a teacher from Dallas. Her name was Karen Gresham Nickel. And Karen was a therapist to me, a spiritual teacher. She meant so, so much to me. But unfortunately, she passed away before I was able to publish my book, before I really had launched into this line of work. But I believe that Karen is still watching over me from her position, wherever it is she is in the universe right now. She was a major influence for me.
So for someone that gives a lot to clients and helps them out, how do you balance that pie chart where you have to take care of your own mental well-being and also provide for others? Because it's not just like you were in marketing or another profession where you're not doing something that's directly benefiting mental health. How do you do that? How do you parlay those?
I walk a lot. I really like to hike, and walking and hiking are fantastic ways for me to relax, but also exercise at the same time. And being in nature has always been a major way of how I feel loved and supported and healthy. So one of my major ways of self-care is walking and hiking.
So everyone out there has a perception or an idea of who they think you are. Your family, your friends, your clients, but ultimately you're in control of your life. What's your perception of you? Who do you think you are?
I am an eternal optimist. I've had a lot of things go south in my life, but somehow I have found the right teachers and friends and perspective to figure out how to stand back up again after falling down. And that's kind of who I am. I think it's who I've been since I was a little girl. Someone the other day started calling me Sunshine, and I kind of like that. I feel a little bit like Sunshine. Not sure why. It's just who I am.
So when you lean back in that easy chair at the end of the day and think about your life up to this point, what are you the proudest of?
What am I the proudest of? Well, maybe my son. My son is 19, and I have raised him most of his life as a single mom, and he's turning out okay. At 19, he's not fully baked yet, but being a mom is something I'm very proud of.
Of all the clients that you've worked with, what's been the best fan letter response that you've gotten from somebody that you always remember?
I think my favorite success story is with a client I helped last year who was afraid of bumblebees. She was so afraid of bumblebees, she would run from her car to the office because she couldn't stand to be outside, and she couldn't go to picnics that her boyfriend's company was hosting. And our work together helped uncover that she had a childhood memory of her sister being in the hospital while she was in a hospital garden with her mother, and she had somehow miswired, crisscrossed the fear of bees with the fear and anxiety that her sister might pass away. She was a very little girl. And when we found this and were able to rewire her brain, she is now able to go outside, and she has assured me she doesn't love the outdoors, but she's not afraid anymore. And it just feels so good to be able to help open up parts of people's life, including hers.
That is the fascinating enigma of the brain that can get wrapped into a phobia that really is boiled down to a simplicity like that. I mean, it's complex, but it's, you know,
right.
it's that memory trauma that can trigger things. And I think sometimes we don't even know it. And I guess that's another part of what you do and how you help people. Can just somebody, is there any way that she would have figured that out on her own?
I don't think so. I mean, it's not to say it couldn't happen, but I don't think she would have ever gotten to that on her own. Hypnosis is really powerful, and self-hypnosis is fantastic and can do people a load of good. But there are some people who have buried a memory, who have a problem that they really need a guide or a helper to help them get out of, where professional hypnosis is the way to go. Because I don't think she would have ever figured that out.
Oh, I don't think most people will ever figure those things out. I guess that was more of me just kind of playing devil's advocate. So, you know, the one thing about what you're doing and helping people realize with the bumblebee is that, you know, part of your power is that you can walk in those footsteps and understand that. Has there been a fear or there been a phobia or something in your life that you overcame that helped you understand that feeling and give you the confidence to really dig in and help people to do that themselves?
I don't know if it was so much a fear, but maybe more of a recognition that life is short. So my first husband, Bruce, was a sick person his whole life. He was sick when I met him. Then he had a lung transplant and lived another 10 years. But Bruce was a person who never expected to live very long because of his health condition. And so he really showed me that life is short. And then when my following partner, Scott, got sick and passed away during COVID, I feel like I was hit on the head again. Life is short. And I think that's maybe kind of the lesson that I've come to, is that if life is short, you got to live as much as you can while you're here. That's what I'm trying to do.
Yeah, well, and I guess you would probably understand that more than anything, the level of mortality. I mean, we always say life is precious and it's short and all of those things. You probably understand it acutely in a way that most people don't.
I think, I hate to say it, but I think that's probably true. I mean, I've had a few more landmines in my life than a lot of other people I know.
I've really tried my hardest. My son's godfather, I have a son who's on the autism spectrum, and his godfather is one of my best friends, and he lost his wife to cancer about 6 years ago.
Oh.
And I remember, you know, I've been really close with him. I was really close with her. And I remember through that process, my mantra to him was, you do everything at your pace. Like, everybody would have this advice, and you got to do this, and you got to do that. But I remember even telling him recently, I said, I never told you how to go through this grieving process. I think that's really important for people that go through that, you know, because everybody kept telling him what he had to do. So I guess that's my question to you. Isn't there more power in allowing people to do what they have to do instead of telling them what they need to do?
We as a culture can't handle grief. We don't talk about it. We don't know what to do when something happens like that. Nobody knows what to say. At the end of the day, I feel what's important from my experience is to simply be with your friend, be with the person who's lost someone, and just literally be there for them. There isn't a whole lot to say. They must go through that process in their own fashion, in their own way. It's not, in rare cases, is it appropriate to advise someone who's grieving what to do. The important thing when one is grieving is to grieve and feel that loss and experience it, because the only way to get better is through. And a timeline, that doesn't make sense. People grieve at their own pace. You know, there are people who seem to be doing better a few months later, and there are people who 20 years later are still talking about and feeling and being very emotionally connected to their person who passed. So there's no right or wrong way about it. I don't feel it's appropriate to tell grievers what to do.
Yeah, I don't either. So, Michelle, if anybody wants to learn more about you, your services, anything related to your world, where's the best place for them to go?
The best place is my website. My website is michellewalters.net, michellewalters.net.
And there they can get the book. Anything they need, they can find it there.
Everything is there.
I love it.
Everything is there. The how to get a hold of me, how to schedule a one-on-one call, the info about the book. Everything is there built into that hub.
Wonderful. Michelle, hey, thank you for taking time out today. Good luck with everything. Have a great holiday season.
Thank you. Thanks so much to you. I appreciate it. Happy holidays.
Thanks for tuning in to another famous interview with Joe Dimino, where we cover the world of art, literature, business, spirituality, and music from around the globe. If you want to hear more interviews, visit the Famous Interviews with Joe Dimino channel on YouTube. Thanks again for listening, and until next time.